And so, Final Fantasy IV becomes the first game to span more than 3 episodes on this show. Last time, I defeated the final boss 3 times, with every party member used to unlock all of their Lunar Trials. So I take the Lunar Whale northeast of the Crystal Palace to where the Moai is, to find a set of stairs beneath it leading into the Lunar Ruins. There are 9 trials in this place, one for each party member, but with Porom and Palom sharing one. Between each trial is 3 floors. These floors are all randomised from a selection of between 4 and 6 for each trial, and so I head south into my first randomised room. I start in the middle of the 4-way fork and go east to my first chest. I then go south and west into a hidden passage, follow it south and exit east, then go south some more, west and north of the second chest. I return to where I started and go south, east and north to the stairs up to the next floor. The first chest has an X potion. My first new Lunar Ruins exclusive enemy is the Goblin Prince. With one exception, every new enemy in this place is simply a palette swap of an old monster. Cid reaches level 59 from killing these. My next fight gets a palette swap of the Vampirus, the Echidna. Killing it gets Cecil to level 61. The second chest is a Phoenix Down, then it's down to the next floor. From where I start, I go all the way north and east through a wall. I keep going east, taking a detour south from my first chest, until I reach the eastmost stairs going north. I take them and go west through the wall to my second chest. I go back down the stairs and take the other set south. I then go west through a wall to the third chest, backtrack through and go south to the next floor. The first chest is a remedy, the second is an elixir. Palom and Porom reach level 62 and Yang reaches level 60 from the next fight. The third chest is an X potion and Cid reaches level 60. I hang out by the exit for a few minutes until I face my first Lamia Queen. Killing it gets Cecil to level 62 and I head off to the next floor. From where I start, I go southeast to my first chest, then back to where I started and all the way south and west to the second chest. Then it's all the way east, in a wall, out of the wall and back in and all the way north until I can exit west and go north some more to the exit. The first chest has a cottage, the second has a dry ether. That's all and that's 3 of the randomised rooms passed through, bringing me to my first Lunar Trial. The Fabul theme playing here makes it clear that this is the Daughter Yang's trial. The rooms containing the trials are the only places in the Lunar Ruins containing save points. They're also the only places you can exit from, as teleport doesn't work in this place. I enter the door and Yang remarks that this room looks like a training area. Moving forward, Yang is challenged by the Lunar Titan to show his strength. Yang's Lunar Trial is the easiest of the lot. I head forward and get challenged by Monk Warriors. I have to face 8 of these. While most of the new enemies added through FF4 Advance were simple palette swaps of all enemies, this enemy type is the only one to have entirely new sprites created. Another extra detail is that each Monk Warrior is actually 3 monks, and as they take damage, one or two of them will fade away before the last one. Killing them all gets Porom and Palom to level 63. Moving forward puts me in a second fight with 8 Monk Warriors. Yang reaches level 61 from them. Moving further some more puts me against 8 of a stronger variant of them, the Super Monk. They fight the same, just have more HP. Killing these gets Cid to level 61. I go north some more where a large group of them is waiting, asking for help training. This gets me another battle against 8 Super Monks. Notice that I cast Float on myself before this. I'll get to that later, but before this fight is the last chance to do that. Winning gets Cecil to level 63. More monks want to train and we get 8 of the strongest Monk Warrior variant, the Master Instructor. Porom reaches level 64. I get one more fight against 8 more Master Instructors. Yang reaches level 62 and Palom level 64 from defeating them. Before the last lot tried to fight me, they're stopped by the Lunar Titan. Lunar Titan will offer to lend his powers if he's defeated. This is why I cast Float on the party beforehand, so that Lunar Titan's Earthquake wouldn't affect me. Lunar Titan has 120,000 HP. Apart from Earthquake, he has a single physical attack that deals between 1 and 2,000 damage, Stone Gaze to petrify, and the Demon Wall's Crush, which is an instant kill, but he doesn't use it much. So I have Cecil, Yang and Cid beat him down, Porom heal, and Palom cast Flare. With Earthquake rendered useless, he can't really do much to me. Thanks to Palom's Flare hitting the damage cap, I'm doing around a combined 20,000 damage a turn, so he goes down quite easily. He drops the Summon Book LT. The Summon Books are a single use item that summons a Lunar Eidolon for an effect stronger than the regular version. You can only have one at a time, and using it will reopen the Lunar Trial for you to be able to repeat it. This is going to be very important in 2 episodes' time. Lunar Titan rewards Yang with the Martial Armlet. Equipping this changes Yang's focus command to the much stronger Deadly. Deadly has Yang skip a single turn to deal triple damage the next. It's very likely to consistently keep hitting the damage cap. After leaving the trial, I go to the north of the entrance to move deeper into the Lunar Ruins. My next randomised room is very simple. We're out of the area of 100% Lunar Subterrane based rooms. Here I'm dropped into the centre of the Antlion Pit. I go north to the exit, but go around the edge of the room to find a single chest, then I backtrack to that exit. On the way, Cid reaches level 62. The one chest in here has an elixir inside. The next fight has Cecil reach level 64. The next floor it gives me is a small segment of the Giant of Babel. It's just a straight walk north with two chests on the way. The two chests are an explosion and dry ether, and I leave without a single fight. Third floor it gives me is a reuse of the East Lunar Tunnel. Northeast for the first chest, then west, north and northeast to the second, then west a little and north to the exit. While I'm in here, I use a siren to trigger a battle with a new bomb variant, the Bomb King. The first chest is a college and the second a Phoenix Down, and it's off to the next floor. This floor contains Edward's Lunar Trial, but since Edward isn't in the party, I can't do it, so I move on to the next floor. Oh, I hate this floor. It sounds simple. An old man wants me to find the book on Massilian history. I have to check all these bookshelves for the randomised spot the book is while following the clues given out by the other scholars. It's fine on its own, but despite the floors being randomised, I seem to get this one every time, and when I need to grind out certain trials next episode, this dragged things out a huge amount. There's no items here, so I just have to find the book and give it to the guy so he can let me leave. This next room is a little confusing, as there are many one-way waterfalls that lead to doors that place you back at the beginning, and I need to take some of these wrong routes to reach some chests. I start by taking the eastern waterfall, then another east, then south down two more to some stairs to a chest, then north to a door that takes me back to the start. I once again take the eastern waterfall, then go directly south down two more, then east and up some stairs to the second chest. I go down those stairs again and south to the door back to the start. Third journey has me take the western waterfall, then take the next western waterfall available to some stairs to the third chest, then west across a bridge and north back to the beginning. My fourth and final journey through has me take the western waterfall and then go directly south to the edge of the screen. I go up the stairs and east and south to the next floor. I get a new Sahagin variant in here, the Sahagin Prince. The first chest is an X potion, the second is a white dress, which is for Rosa. The third chest has a cottage. During my last run through, Porum and Palum reach level 65, then it's Yang to level 63. A couple minutes later, Cid also reaches level 63. After that, it's on to the next floor. This floor has an old man make me play a counting game. Various animals and a monk will run by into a house and I have to choose the correct answer out of three for how many of a certain thing pass by. Getting it right gets you a megalixir, getting it wrong gets you nothing. Either way, you can move on to the next floor. It's the next trial, but Illusionary World is playing, identifying this as Rydia's trial. She isn't in the party, so I move on again. This is another floor I hate. There's a man blocking the exit who'll only let me pass if I catch a platinum toad. The toad is in the northwest corner of the map, but blinks away to another location if you don't get it in time. And when you do fight the platinum toad, it reflects itself when hit by spells, give protect if hit physically, and flees often. Defeating this one gets Porum to level 66. And I didn't even get the toad. Actually catching the thing after putting in the effort to defeat it is a random chance. The next one I defeat gets Palum to level 66. Also Cecil to 65 too at some point and I don't know when. In the end it takes me defeating 4 or 5 of them to finally catch it. I give it to that prick and move on. Next room I get is based on the passage of the Eidolons. I head south through a passage to a fork. First I go west which brings me to my first chest, then back and east which leads to my second. I return once more and go south, then east into a hidden passage, follow it south and go all the way west through another wall to my third chest, then north to the exit. Not marked down on this map are the many enemies I had to talk to and fight that are blocking the path. I'll skip over most of these as they aren't interesting and are mostly returning enemies. One fight gets Yang to level 64. The first chest is an elixir. Then Cecil reaches level 66. The second chest is also an elixir. One of the forced encounters gets a new enemy, the Elite Guard. Cid reaches level 64. Close to the third chest I get a Chaos Knight, another new enemy. Killing this one gets Porum to level 67. Same with Palum from the next fight. The third chest contains Asura's Rod, a holy element weapon for Palum. I then leave and get a town. These can appear in most sections of the ruins. They have an inn and sell high-end consumables. Just leaving town to the south will take me to the next floor. This time it's a trial I can actually do, it's Cecil's. As I enter, a voice challenges Cecil to prove himself as a true paladin. What this means is that there will be 5 randomised scenarios given to me. I then have to go through them behaving as a proper paladin would. How many rooms I do correctly will determine my prize at the end. The first one I get is a cave with the exit blocked off by a goblin. The goblin begs me not to kill him as he's a cursed human. I just have to stay still and wait for the curse to wear off. Killing him fails this room. With the curse undone, the soldier thanks me and walks off, and I can move to the next room. The next room has me next to a lake where there's someone drowning. I could just ignore them and walk to the next room, but to be a good paladin, I have to walk over there and save them. On to the next room. This one has a room with many chests being emptied by a burglar. To be a good paladin, I have to refuse to keep quiet, making me have to fight a bandit. I defeat him and move on to the next room. The fourth room it gives me has four kids bullying a pig. To fail, I have to just ignore them and move on. To pass, I have to individually talk to each of the kids to have Cecil scold them. Although, Cecil has the wrong idea about this. Instead of bullying is wrong, he goes with fight one on one. Cecil's fine with bullying, but as long as you bully honourably. Once the kids run off, I can move on. The last room I get has a girl ask Cecil to return her missing chocobos. They're all running around this screen and I have to just talk to each one to send them back to pass this room and be on my way. That's five rooms cleared, and at the end is a king who gives me a chest containing a reward based on how many rooms I clear properly. Doing all five correctly gets me the Lightbringer, Cecil's new strongest sword. It's not just stronger than the Ragnarok, it also has a chance of casting a free holy after a physical attack. I equip it and talk to the king, who reveals himself as Lunar Odin and challenges me. Lunar Odin has 95,000 HP and keeps the original's lightning weakness. He also functions like the original Odin, raising his sword in preparation for Zantetsken. He's quite easy. I cast Slow on him with Purim, have Sid and Cecil attack, Yang use Deadly, and Palom casting Fundiger. Fundiger combined with Sid's lightning element hammer already does a lot, but added with Yang's Deadly and the chance of Cecil's attack being extended with Holy, I can do nearly 40,000 damage a turn. Purim dies once from the first Zantetsken, but other than that he goes down very quickly. I get Summon Book LO and that's two trials down. Time to move on to the next section. This one is very simple, a small Giant of Babel room with two chests north above the exit. I just go north to the next room. The two chests are an X Potion and Dry Aether. Next room. This one is based on the mountains. I go south, then west to a chest, then south and west again to the exit. My first fight gets Yang to level 65. The only chest is a Red Fang. Using a Siren gets me my next new enemy, the Coel Regina. Then it's to the next floor, based on the first room of the Lodestone Cavern. I go east, past the stairs to the first chest. I then go south down those stairs, east, south across the bridge, west across the bridge, and north of the exit. The chest is an elixir. Cecil reaches level 67, Cid reaches level 65, and I move to the next floor. Theme of Love is playing, meaning this is Rosa's trial and I can't enter it, so I move on. The first floor I get for the 6th section is based on the underground waterway. I go south, east across two bridges, south and west to the early chest. I then backtrack between the first two bridges and go north, east and north to the exit. The chest is a blue fang and that's all. The next floor it gives me is based on a room from the Barren Waterway. I go down the stairs and south through the hidden passage to the first chest. Then south through another hidden passage and north to a second chest. I go east into a third hidden passage and southeast to a third chest. Then east through one last hidden passage and north to the exit. The first chest has a Gisal Whistle. The second has a Remedy. My first fight in here gets Purim and Palom to level 68. The third chest has a Dry Aether. This next room is based on the Sealed Cave. I go north through the first door to the first chest. From the first door I go east to the second door leading to a room with two more. Then from that door I go south to the exit. The first chest has a Dragoon Plate for Cain and the second has a cottage. I then get a fight with my first Fiend Dragon. These can be scary as they can cast Maelstrom on the party. You don't want to end up fighting two at once. The next fight has another new enemy, the Crystal Dragon. The third chest is a Dry Aether and I move on. This trial has Troy and Beauty playing, which doesn't give it away. For some reason they chose this to represent Edge despite him having nothing to do with Troyer. But to be fair, Edge never had a character theme, his moments usually use Cid's theme. Time for the next floor. It's another one I hate, look at this mess. I start by going west, south and west to the first chest, then back to the start. I go east, south down bridges until my first east, and south all the way. I go west all the way, south, east and south to the second chest. I backtrack north, west and north, then take the first set of stairs east to the north. Then north a lot more, west a little, and southwest to the third chest. I backtrack to the point I turned south and go west, south, west, south, west, south, east and south to the exit. The first chest is a cottage. Yang reaches level 66. Hidden in the crate on the way to the second is Loki's loot, a weapon for Edward. Soon after, Cecil reaches level 68. Next fight has a new enemy, Strato Avis. The second chest gets me an elixir. Then Cid reaches level 66. The third chest is a Dry Aether and I move on to the next room, which is also a cave. Here there are just two soldiers, who comment that they should have brought a mage before walking off screen, never to be seen again. I go all the way east and then south onto this bridge. Halfway down the bridge I get off slightly east and go south and west to the first chest. I then return to the bridge and go west and south all the way. I follow the west side of the screen north until I reach a bridge going east, which leads to the second chest. I backtrack and follow the west edge again to the north edge for the third chest. I backtrack down the west edge to a bridge I skipped earlier and take it north to the exit. This room is entirely filled with Flan type enemies, including some new ones, such as Golden Flan and Dust Moose. Killing this lot gets Porom and Pelham to level 69. First chest is an elixir, second chest is yet another dry ether, possibly the most common treasure in this dungeon. Third chest is a Gasal whistle, then it's off to the next floor. This floor has no treasures or enemies, it's just a long winding path to some sylves in a lake who fully heals the party for free. This next trial is another one I can't do, as it's for Cain, so moving on. Next up is the bomb room. I go east, north, west and south to a section with two hidden treasures. I return to the start and go west and south to a section with two more. From there I just go all the way north to the exit. Instead of random encounters, this room has moving bombs that when walked into, trigger a fight. One kind exclusive to this floor is the melt bomb. These self-destruct often and don't drop XP or gil when killed, they don't even get added to the bestiary. In the north section, a pot has a bomb crank and the southeast corner has a megalixir. The southwestern section has a bomb crank in a pot and a bomb fragment in another. That's it for this one. This room is a long fetch quest of grabbing items and using them to move forward. I've marked the items' locations with letters. I first go east from the entrance to item A, then it's to the east side for item B in a pot and through the door to the north. I grab item C from the pot and go east. I go north through a door and grab item D in the middle of the room. I go east and north to item E, then south and west around the rocks and through a hidden passage to the only chest. I return to where I got item C and go north through two doors and east to the exit. A marks me grabbing some purified water from the pond. B is some firewood. The door to the north of the firewood has a picture of a dead tree, so I use the purified water to give it life and open the door. C is some honey. The door east of the honey is a door with a picture of a bear. I give it the honey to open the door. D is an open flame that I put the firewood in to create a torch. E is a doll. The chest is a megalixir. Yang reaches level 67. The door north of where I found the honey has the image of a lightless lantern on it, so I use a torch to open it. Then Cecil reaches level 69. The next door has the image of a lonely girl, so I give her a doll to open that and I can keep going. I get another town this time, a different layout but pretty much the same stuff. I rest at the inn and go into the armor shop here. I buy Yang a battle gear and Sid a Maximilian. The battle gear is especially good as it makes Yang immune to curse, pig and toad. I also buy Palom a chocobo suit and Porom a tabby suit. All that combined was over 2 million gil. I then leave town for the next lunar trial, and this one I can actually do, as it's for Sid. As I enter, it starts me on an island south of Thabul next to the Enterprise. As I take off, there's an old man on board who says he needs to get to Mysidia. Sid agrees, and then the guy says he's so hungry he needs to get back within a minute and 20 seconds. This is the gimmick for this trial, testing your knowledge of the world map so you can get between places within the time limit. This one's easy. Directly north takes me to Mount Ordeals, and then west of that is Mysidia. I get it done in less than 20 seconds. The guy heads home, only for a white mage to approach Sid and say she needs to deliver medicine. I have 60 seconds to get to Troyer. I go north until I hit Mount Hobbs, then west until I see the Lodestone Cavern. From there I can navigate to Troyer in under 30 seconds. The white mage leaves without a rush, making Sid think these people are having him on. A monk shows up needing to get to Thabul in under 40 seconds. This just needs me to go east until I reach the desert south of Thabul, then go north a little and I'm there in less than half that time. Turns out the monk was just worrying about his train collection. That's the first I've ever heard of trains in this game's world. I didn't think they'd have them. An old man runs out of the castle wanting to go to Kaipo. His daughter's wedding starts in 35 seconds. I go south from Thabul to the island I started on and then go west directly to Kaipo. But I can't land right outside because there's no grass. So I head closer to Mist, land there and walk the rest of the way. The old man asks Sid if he has a daughter too, to which he says he does, along with another who's like a daughter, meaning Rosa. Once he leaves, a kid wants to see his grandmother in Agard and wants him to get him there in under 30 seconds. All I have to do is fly directly north from where I landed and it takes me there in no time. Once the kid leaves, Cecil comments on the rough time it must have been. We return to the airship for lightning to strike. Lunarama is irritated at what he sees as a bug constantly flying around his skies. Lunarama has 90,000 HP, absorbs lightning damage and has no weaknesses. He has a physical attack and uses all the strong lightning spells you'd expect. As usual, Cecil and Sid attack while Yang uses Deadly and Palom casts Flare. Porom starts with Holy and then switches over to healing. The biggest pain is that he tends to counter everything I do with either Thundergar or Thunderbolt, so he kills my party members often, meaning Porom is burning through her MP casting Arise a lot. He raises his staff in preparation for his strongest attack, but I finish him first, raising Sid to level 67 and making him drop Summon Book LR. He also drops the Flare Sledgehammer, Sid's strongest weapon. The Enterprise is brought down and the party wake up back in the ruins. Like the Lightbringer, the Flare Sledgehammer maxes out Sid's attack at 255 and can cast Flare for free randomly after an attack. With that done, I move on to the next section. It's another room based on the Giant of Babel. South and west are the first chest, south, west, north, west, south, east, and north to the second. East, south, east, north, and all the way to the northeast corner for the third. South, west for the fourth, and north to the exit. First chest is a cottage, second a guitar whistle, the third is Mutsunokami, a weapon for Edge. Fourth chest is a megalixir, and I move forward. Another floor based on the passage of Eidolons. I go east of the first chest, to the northwest corner for the second, then the northeast corner for the exit. My first fight here gives me a new Chimera variant, the Chimera Geist. The next fight has Porum and Palum reach level 70. The first chest is a megalixir and the second a cottage. Before I leave, I use a siren to summon the rarest enemy in this floor, the Marlboro Menace. Then it's to the next floor. This time it's based on the lowest floors of the Lunar Subterrane. It's a simple west, south, east, south, west of the exit, grabbing a chest on the way. The chest is a megalixir, that's all. And I move on to the final trial in this place, Porum and Palum's. As I enter, Palum spots a slab blocking the path forward, and something written on it. It basically says that the twins have to split up and go down their own paths to help each other get through the trial. So they each walk off in opposite directions. I go east and talk to Porum. Both her and Palum have each found a small passage only they can squeeze through. So they both go in. As Palum, I go west to press a switch to open a door on Porum's end. The door in Palum's room is blocked, so I swap to Porum. To the east is a switch to open said door, and I go through the door Palum opened. In this next room I stand on a nearby tile to get Porum minned. I go east and step on a tile that gives her float, and use it to walk south over these cracked floor tiles to find another switch that opens a door on Palum's side. I head back to the locked door I passed, and swap back to Palum. I take Palum through the first door I opened and move west. A toad walks by, spots Palum, and flees through a nearby hole. Going all the way west takes me to a tile that toads me, so I can also enter that hole. At the back of the room it leads to, there's a switch to open the door I left Porum in front of. I then go west and north into the second door I opened for this side. I head east to step on a tile that pigs him, and then go north to a locked door. Back to Porum and through the door Palum opened. A mini emerges from the wall and runs off to the previous room. I go through the hole and find a locked door and get pigged next to it. This opens the door and I go in. I go west to stand on a switch, which makes Porum hear something moving. I go back to the previous room, where I can now go east to a switch that opens Palum's door. Back in the room I came from, I go north through a hole to another door. Back to Palum and through the door. To the west is a mini tile, and directly in front of the door is a hole to go through. North a little bit is a switch that opens a door for Porum. I then go west and through another door. To the east is a locked door and a tile that floats Palum. Even further east is a hole I pass through. There's another hole, but first I go west to stand on another switch to make something move. I then go through a second hole and step on another switch, but nothing happens. Back to Porum and through her door. Then northwest through another door. I go east, float myself, and keep going east to find a hole I need to be a toad to pass through. To the south is an exit into another room. Next to the door is a switch that unlocks Palum's next door. To the east is another door leading to a toad tile and a hole. I go through it and north through another to find another green switch, like the one I just found as Palum. Standing on it has the twins talk to each other about what they're even for. In the end, they decide to both press them at once. Back with Cecil, the slab from earlier sinks into the ground and the twins reunite with the rest of the party. I move north to meet an old man. It's the Lunar Leviathan, acting as the final test of the trial. Lunar Leviathan has 135,000 HP and a lightning weakness. He'll use Blizzaker and Deluge depending on whether his mouth is open or closed. He also has Maelstrom, which can be very scary, and uses Tidal Wave regularly. As usual, Porum is on healing duty, casting Holy whenever the party is at full health on her turn. While Cecil and Sid attack, Yang uses Deadly, and Palum casts Fundiger. In retrospect, I should have changed Sid's weapon back, as Force Hammer's element would do more damage than the non-elemental Flare Sledgehammer. Despite having the highest HP of any boss face so far, he ends up being a pushover against this party. I guess Summon Book LL from this. My reward is the Twin Stars. When both of their twins are equipped with these, their twin cast spell will instead become Meteor. Well, those are all the Lunar Trials I can do with this party, but there are still a few more floors to go, so I decide I'll clear them out now. This next room is a simple walk from south to north. Halfway through there's a chest that gets me the Vishnu Vest, exclusive armour for Edward. I hang around by the exit to get my next new power swap enemy, the King Behemoth. Killing it gets Yang to level 68. Next new enemy I get here is the Iron Giant. Out of the first 10 games, this game was one of only two starting from its debut in FF2 to not have Iron Giants originally. So here they get to appear as repainted armour constructs. Killing this gets settled to level 70. Next fight gets me a Gill Snapper. Then a Katurbal Pass, another recurring enemy that skipped this game and got added in the GBA version as a palette swap of another enemy. After that, I move into the next room. There's two mages complaining about their magic not working before they walk off and disappear. From where I start, I go northeast, east and south down the second passage, then east, north, east and south to my first chest. I return to where I started and go northwest, south, west all the way, east, and take the first north to the second chest. I take that east again, and the second north, then east and north to the third chest. Back to that east I was taking, I go all the way for the fourth chest. I backtrack and take the first north east of the second chest and follow that path east, south, east and north to the exit. I get the newest worst enemy in the game on this floor, the Proto Death Mask. Just take a regular death mask and roid it up a bit. Fuck him. I kill the one and run away from every other. Killing it gets Sid to level 68. The first chest is a red fang, the second is a blue fang, the third is actually useful, it's a ribbon I give to Palom, but the fourth chest is another white fang. That's all for this floor as I ran from all the other fights. But then for the last floor of this section, I get this one. An old man tells me not to face the dragon on this floor. This dragon you can't miss, as it has the biggest sprite in the game next to the Giant of Babel. I ignore the old geezer and take him on anyway. So, the Brachioridos. It fucks me up. It one-shots Yang with Inferno, has physical attacks dealing over 2000 damage, plus it can attack two characters in one turn. I get a few good hits in, but then it begins a countdown from 3. But I interrupt that countdown by hitting it. It casts Protect and Reflect on itself and starts bouncing the strongest spells off itself for 9999 damage. 3 spells at a time. With 3 party members dying at once, I can't keep up the healing and he takes me out. This means I have to repeat everything I did after I finished the Twins Trial. But it's odd. I was certain on the GBA that the dungeon was always randomised, so resetting the game after saving or dying would give me a different set of floors every time. But it seems on PSP, the Lunar Ruins random floors are decided on and fixed the moment you enter. Changing floors by saving and resetting doesn't work. Or I might just be remembering it wrong and it was always like this. Second try ends in death, as was my third. Let's skip ahead to my 6th successful attempt after an hour of retracing my steps. The Brachioridos has 180,000 HP. I've already mentioned Inferno and the double attack, what about that triple spell Reflect? Well, the countdown is counting down to Mega Flare. Now Mega Flare is preferable to the spell bouncing as it's easier to survive. Just gotta get some Reflects in and hope it doesn't use Black Hole to get rid of them. All of my deaths were caused by it starting the countdown after I'd set an attack, so there was nothing I could do. Of course, Cecil and Sid attack, Yang deadly, Palom flare and revive while Porom is busy. I have Porom cast slow on it first, then haste on herself, then reflect on whoever I can get it on before the Mega Flare comes out. I get reflect on everyone but Sid before that Mega Flare goes off. This is where that collection of elixirs comes in, as even with slow, this thing is just too fast to rely solely on Porom for healing. Plus my reflect would bounce the healing spells anyway. This time I finally get reflect on the entire party. It gets a bit dicey when Palom's reflect wears off on the one count, but I get it back on in time. The trick is to only set an attack right after it does, so you know its turn isn't coming up to start that countdown. Its fourth Mega Flare cycle ends up being its last, as I managed to bring it down 2 attacks later. That was the hardest fight in the game, harder than the actual super boss. I win the Hero Shield, which anyone can equip and absorbs all elemental damage. This is very good, and I can get multiple. I give this one to Cecil. The old man refuses to acknowledge my killing it though. I leave the room, which leads to one more room with a save point and exit. Nothing I can do here right now, so I leave. And that was all just my first journey through the Lunar Ruins. I go back to Mysidia and kick everyone out for Cain, Rosa, Edward and Edge. While they were away, Cain and Edward reached level 70, Edge level 69 and Rosa level 68. I then give them the new equipment I got for them the first time through. Dragoon Plate for Cain, Loki's Loot and Vishnu Vest for Edward, White Dress for Rosa and Mutsunokami for Edge. And it's back in for another go. This time I won't be listing the level ups until my next save, to make it easier to skim through repeated floors. The first floor I get in Yang's section is a repeat, but the second is new. From the start I go east and then south all the way, entering a hidden passage going east and following it to the eastern edge of the room where I go north for my first chest. Back through the hidden passage I go west all the way, north, take the first east, north and west through another hidden passage to the second chest. Then from the last fork, it's northeast to the exit. The first chest is a dry ether, the second a remedy, then it's moving on. Third floor is a repeat, so I'm still missing one floor in Yang's section. Edward's section next. First is a repeat, as is the second. For my third floor, I get another barren waterway inspired room. I go south across the bridge, then east to another and north up it, then west and south down the stairs. From there I go all the way to the northeastern corner up the stairs, then all the way south to my first chest. I retrace my steps down that last set of stairs and go all the way west and up two more sets of stairs, then west some more to my second chest. Back down the stairs and east a little, then north to the exit. First chest is a cottage, second is the next portion, and it's onto the room with Edward's trial. During these 6 floors it took to get here, Cecil Kane and Edward reached level 71, Edge level 70, and Rosa level 69. This time I can now enter Edward's lunar trial. We end up at a frozen Damsian castle. Edward hears a voice and moves forward to find a harp, the Requiem harp. This is only available during this trial. It disappears once we leave. A voice begs for help and a flame appears to start a fight. The apparition is like the melt bomb. You can kill it, but you get no reward from it. I go north into the castle where there are 2 more apparitions. However, these ones, when killed, will simply respawn. I have to equip the Requiem harp and use Edward's bard song to release their souls. With those 2 done, I take the stairs to the next floor where there is only 1 apparition to save. Then it's up the stairs again into the ruined throne room to save 2 more. Turns out, back in the first room I missed one of the apparitions, so I helped that one out too. With them all saved, the party feel cold air coming from somewhere. Edward follows it to a cave. I couldn't find a big enough map of this screen, so you'll just have to bear with me. I get in the water and follow it east, south, west, north, up the stairs, north, west, south, west, north, west, south across the bridge to the first apparition of this room. After dealing with it, I go south, west, north, east, north, and east to the second. After that, it's west through a hidden passage back to the start. This time I go east along the northern wall, north, east, south across the bridge, and south down the eastern edge to the third apparition. I then take the western edge going south, then the first west to the fourth. Once it's dealt with, I go back east across the bridge, south, west, north, west, north, west, south, west, north, west, south, east, south, west, south, east, south, east, north, and west across a bridge to the fifth and final apparition. I go back across the bridge, south, west, north, west, north, west, south, east, and south, which leads to the exit of this room. In the next room, I head north where Edward is attacked, breaking the Requiem harp. Ice forms around Edward and we take on the source of the freezing, Luna Shiva. Luna Shiva has 100,000 HP, absorbs ice, and has a fire weakness. She has a physical attack, Blizzager, and Frost Blast, which hits the entire party. She responds to magic damage by casting Blizzager on herself to heal, and she has Ice Storm as her strongest attack. Cecil, Edge, and Edward attack, Kane jumps, and Rosa heals and sets buffs. Cecil is perfectly safe in this fight, as a hero shield means he absorbs all of Luna Shiva's strongest attacks for thousands of HP. Maybe I should have brought Rizia instead of Edge, as her Fireager would do loads more than Edge's Flame, which Luna Shiva can heal over. Edge dies once, but apart from that, she isn't very hard. Fittingly, Edward gets the last hit, winning me Summon Book LS. One last apparition thanks Edward before disappearing, leaving him the Harmony Ring. When equipped, this makes Edward's Bard Song cast Protect and Shell on the party. And it's back to exploring Rizia's section. The first floor I get gives me a Sylph that fully heals me right after I've just used a cottage. The second is a repeat. This third one is another I hate, it just slows things down. An old man tells me a string of numbers and I have to run around pressing those numbered tiles in order. There's nothing interesting about it and it just wastes time, moving on. Still can't do Rydia's trial, so it's onto Cecil's section. And we get another room I really hate, probably the worst one. This is a confusing teleporter room that's such a mess I can't even map it out. As you can follow the proper path and it will still send you back multiple rooms for no reason, it's semi-random. I've been through this floor several times by the time I was done with this and I still don't know what its deal is. So I'll skim over it and cover the chests instead. The first chest I find has a dry ether, the second an next potion, and the last one has Sasuke's katana, the other strongest katana for Edge. This lets him join Cecil and Cid in maxing out the attack stat. Soon after, I leave and have to do that bastard platinum toad room again. Skipping ahead, at some point I use the Lunar Odin's book on the way, so Cecil's trial is open again. There is a good reason to repeat this one, there's some new tests I didn't get last time. First has me break a vase belonging to an old man. To pass the test, I have to admit to it. Next new room I get has 3 monsters attacking soldiers. To pass, I have to kill all 3. Or I could just ignore them and move on, it's not like I can get another Lightbringer. This next one is the one I'm after. An old man dropped a golden apple. To pass this room, I have to find it and return it to him. I don't need the paladin points anymore, so I give it to Edward and move on. Next new room I get has an old man place a megalixir at his dead wife's grave. Since it's not a permanent treasure and respawns whenever I repeat, I have no reason to steal it. So I move on and pass that room. Doing so badly has Lunar Odin give me the Excalibur, a bad sword I get rid of whenever I get the chance. Then I repeat the Lunar Ordering fight and it's off to Rose's section. This time I get a floor based on the Sylph Cave. From the start I go east through Hidden Passage, south, east through another, north a little, east through two more, and north, east into one more, and then south all the way to the chest. Return to the start, then follow the other path south and east to the exit. The chest has Dragon Claws for Yang, and the pot next to the exit has a Megalixir. The other two floors I've already done. By the time I've reached the entrance to Rosa's trial, Cecil, Kane and Edward are level 72, Edge level 71, and Rosa level 70. Now for Rosa's trial. I enter the door to find a town resembling Kaipo, but right away a woman appears and splits into three orbs that curse the townspeople with status ailments, attacking them in general, and just wrecking the place. To the left of Rosa is a soldier she cures. I have to save as many people as I can before time runs out. The orbs circling Rosa represent the time limit, moving closer as it runs out. From the start, I go west to cure a man of pig. Some are fakes though, as north and east is a pig that triggers a time-wasting battle against the Metamorpha, another new enemy. Going north, I cure a soldier and heal someone of Mini. North again and heal another pig. In the northwest corner, I heal a petrified old man. East, I heal another Mini child, then south across the bridge to a Metamorpha hiding as a pig. Southwest is a toad that also turns out to be a Metamorpha. Then to the south is another hiding as a Mini. West of that is a petrified old woman, then to the east is an injured soldier to heal. North to a petrified woman that turns out to be another Metamorpha. Southeast to cure someone of Toad, and then north to heal a soldier. South to cure a pig, then into the water to cure a toad. I then follow the path in the water to the last person to heal, but my time runs out on the way. I get confronted by Luna Asura, who wants Rosa to prove the worth of human existence. Luna Asura has 130,000 HP and no weaknesses. She has all three tier elemental spells along with Mini and Toad. Like the normal Asura, she'll also cast Kuriga on herself, so it's best to have Rosa cast Reflect on her right away. But I decide not to because that would cause an issue with the random Holy from Cecil's Lightbringer though. I decide to go with good old Damage Race. I also have Edward start with his new Bard song to get Protect and Shell on everyone. But apart from that, Kane jumps and the other three attack while Rosa heals. But she also has the chance of using the CPU's Object 199 for an instant kill. She's definitely the toughest of the Lunar Eidolons I've faced so far, leaving a good chunk of my party either minied, dead, or both a lot of the time. This fight goes on for a while, but in the end, a jump from Kane finishes her off. I get the summon book LA. But here's the issue. After she disappears, an old man comes to thank and reward me. But the reward is based on how many people I saved, and I didn't get them all. So I miss out on the unique reward for getting them all and just get a Megalixir instead. Meaning I'll have to repeat this one and do it better my next time through. Now to move back into Edge's section. The next floor is a room from the Tower of Babel. From the start, I just follow the outside edge going north, west and south, then east past the door to the chest, then through that door. The chest is a dry ether and I move on. That's all new for this section, and when I reach the room with Edge's trial, Edge is level 72. I enter Edge's trial to end up in a messed up castle surrounded by water. The layout tickles Edge's ninja instincts and he takes over to explore it. He runs into the door in front of him and it drops him elsewhere. Like Edward's trial, I couldn't find a large enough map to use to show my route, so it'll have to be directions again. So sorry if this ends up a confusing mess. I go north through the door and west. Killing enemies in this place can have them drop keys that can only be used in this trial. On the western side, I go north and east around the back of the castle, then south and through the door furthest to the west. I press the switch on the right to open the door going forward. Then it's a second switch on the left to open the next door. There's a pot here that refills MP if I need to heal. I then take the stairs up to the next floor, then north up more stairs. It takes me to the throne room where I can talk to the king. He responds to Edge's compliments by dropping us through a trapdoor that puts me back in the room with the switches. Returning to the floor the next room up, the stairs are blocked off by flames, so Edge runs through a wall to the east, which triggers another trapdoor that puts me in a new room. I walk across the cracked floor to the red switch to open the red door. I then walk across the other small crack to not fall through, then read the sign next to it saying right 4. This means the four tiles to the right of the sign are an invisible floor. I go through the door I opened and go all the way north, then east a little and south to another sign saying down 1, right 2, down 2, right 1. I then go back north and fall through a crack to a room resembling the Passage of Eidolons. This one I can actually make a map of. However, I mess up first time and take the teleporter to the west to exit back to the castle. Next time I end up landing in a different spot. I go west through a hidden passage, south, east through another to my first chest. Back through that wall and north a little and west through a wall, keep going until I can turn south. I reach a teleport but instead go through the wall to the east to find a second chest. Back through the wall I go through the western one to a third chest. Then into that teleport to take me to the exit. The first chest is a dry ether, the second an X potion, the third also an X potion. Leaving puts me back outside the castle again. Time to follow the directions from that second sign. It takes me to a third saying right 3, up 4, left 4, up 8, right 5. It takes me to 3 sets of stairs going southeast. I ignore them and instead find a blue switch to open the blue door, but the weight of the nearest door is now blocked by a crack that will break if I step on it. So I leave through the door to the south and come back in to reset the crack and go through that door. It leads to a green switch to open the green doors I passed on the way here. I go through the nearest to the stairs and up a different set. In the next room I go south and west through the wall, then south back into the wall, it leading out onto an invisible floor. It leads to the first door requiring a key I've seen so far. At this point I've built up 16 of them. The door leads into the wall and out the other end, and I go north for another MP restoring pot. Then further north and through a wall to another door I unlock. West through the wall and in the wall in the back, and north to another screen. I go through the door directly north of me to find the king again. He's impressed Edge made it back alive and begins the final challenge. Luna E3 has 110,000 HP, absorbs fire and has an ice weakness. But that weakness doesn't matter since no one here has any ice spells. Plus he counters ice magic with Inferno. He also counters all physical attacks with one of his own. The rest of his attacks are the usual fire stuff. Fire, Firiger and Flame. Cecil, Edward, Edge attack, Kane jump, Rosa cast slow and then heals. Even without ice magic to hit the damage cap, this one is really easy and he goes down in no time. I get Summon Book LI and he leaves behind Hanzo's gloves. These change Edge's steal command to Plunder, which does damage while stealing. Edge loved that and wants to go back in. I didn't care for it myself. Probably my least favourite of the Lunar Trials. It's why it's taken me 8 hours to script just the half hour this dungeon took, it was so boring to watch back. The first room I get, continuing into Kane's section, is another new one based on the Lunar Subterrane. From the start I go to the northwest corner and into a hidden passage. I follow it all the way south to 3 chests. I leave the way I came and go south and east into the central area where there are 12 more chests waiting. Then I just head to the exit in the centre south of the screen. The first 3 chests are a golden apple, Perseus's bow and Soma Drop. The golden apple goes to Edward and there's no point wasting another Soma Drop on Kane for a joke, so... The 12 in the middle of the room are a Red Fang, Dry Aether, Blue Fang, Elixir, White Fang, Elixir, Light Curtain, Dry Aether, Cottage, Megalixir, X Potion and X Potion. That's it for this room. Then we get my favourite room. An old man will ask me a question with 2 doors representing the answers. My choices determine my reward. But there's only one that matters. When he asks if I'm intellectual or athletic, I choose athletic. When asked if I use potions or cure spells to restore HP, I choose potions. When he asks where I need to become stronger between a great weapon or to train harder, I choose to train harder. So red door, blue door, red door. The old man says I would be perfect as a monk and gives me a fruit basket. This is a golden apple and a silver apple, so 150 extra HP for no effort. And if you get this room again, you can just repeat those answers for another 150 HP. I give them both to Edward. That's everything new before I reach Kane's trial entrance. Cecil and Kane are level 75, Edward and Edge are level 74, and Rosa is level 73. Before I enter, I make sure to place Kane in the back row, it'll help a lot. When I try to enter, a barrier stops me. Of course, Kane gets the preferential treatment, so his is the only trial that he enters alone. Kane is woken up in Baron Town by Cecil. Kane has no idea what's going on, and Cecil is behaving as if everything is normal. There's a commotion in town because a soldier was attacked the previous night. They head further into town where Rosa checks on Kane. With Kane being found unconscious and the mysterious attack, Cecil decides they should all investigate. One woman says she saw a shadow darting through the sky, jumping across rooftops like a dragoon. One soldier says the victim's wound looks like it came from a spear-like weapon. Another soldier says that the spear is missing and the last civilian basically repeats the woman's description. The last soldier makes the connection between spears and dragoons, but Cecil shuts it down right away, pointing out that Kane was also attacked. The soldier specifies that he didn't just mean Kane, but that dragoons in general are the only ones who use spears. The captain shows up asking for any clues we found, but we don't have any, so he asks anyone who finds anything to come to him. One of his soldiers says they should enlist Cecil's group in their search, Kane especially if the suspect is jumping roof to roof. The captain scares that soldier off, but does admit that they could be helpful. The group agreed to cooperate and the captain says Kane should rest at the inn. Cecil tells Kane to go ahead, as he needs to escort Rosa these 6 steps it will take her to get inside her own house. I go to the inn where a room for Kane is already prepared. As Kane sleeps, he dreams of Rosa blaming him for the attack. Kane wakes up and thinks things over some more. He considers that if not a dragoon, a weaponsmith could have done the attack. When Kane wakes up the next morning, there's a spear by one of the beds. I pick it up to find that it's covered in blood. Going outside, Cecil tells Kane that there's been another attack. It's the guy who runs the weapon shop, and the wound is definitely from a spear and from someone accustomed to using one. Plus, the victim was an important witness. His wife says that he noticed a spear was stolen from his stock. Kane shows Cecil and Rose of a spear he found. None of them have any answers and they decide to hand it over to the soldiers. Cecil tells Kane to be careful since he's already been attacked, then decides he'd best stay at the inn with Kane to be on the safe side. In the middle of the night, Kane gets out of bed just to say he hopes nothing happens, and then gets back in bed. I too get out of bed in the middle of the night just to state a single thought out loud to the audience. The next morning, Cecil is already up. Outside, he's looking for Rosa, telling Kane to get searching for more clues. People in town are starting to become fearful of Kane. I talk to Rosa's mother, who hasn't seen her since yesterday, thinking she was with the other two. In the training hall, the soldiers are holding a strategy meeting. They're getting nothing from the spear. The blood is the weaponsmith's and the only fingerprints are Kane's. Back outside, it's getting dark, so I have Kane go to bed. Kane wakes up from another dream and goes outside. Cecil is still looking for Rosa and asks for Kane's help. No one was looking very hard as she's tied up in the corner of town where the dancer usually is. Cecil shows up to untie Rosa and walk her home. Outside her house, he tells Kane they'll speak tomorrow. Cecil vows to never leave Rosa's side again and I send Kane back to bed. The next morning, I go back to Rosa's house where Cecil asks what happened. She says that she was asleep when she heard someone calling her. Suddenly, she was outside. She tried to return home, but a man dressed in black appeared from above and she woke up in the spot Kane found her. She thinks that's all, but then she remembers hearing someone's voice. She doesn't know whose, but it sounded sad, but kind. Back in the spot I found Rosa, there's a mark in the ground caused by a spear. I return to the inn, where the innkeeper is nervous. In the room, the bloody spear is next to Kane's bed. The soldiers show up and accuse Kane, but the captain stands up for him, saying they don't know for certain. However, he does say he has to restrain Kane, and Kane agrees to answer their questions later. The captain tells him to stay inside until the charges are dropped. They take the spear, leaving one soldier behind to watch Kane. Kane goes to bed, but the voice taunts him again, accusing him and telling him that this is what he wanted, goading him into attacking the guard. Kane gets out of bed and the soldier has already been attacked. He goes outside to see the shadowy figure flee. It runs into Rosa's house and terrorizes her. I go inside and chase it out. I catch the figure who turns out to be another soldier, who drops a spear. The captain shows up and apologizes to Kane for the trouble. They take away the soldier and the spear, the captain thanking Kane for his help before he leaves. With the incident over, Cecil says they should leave town tomorrow and tells Kane he should get some sleep. Kane returns to his room to find the spear in it once again. It tells Kane it isn't over until he is dead, meaning Cecil. Realizing the danger Cecil is in, Kane rushes outside. Cecil silently wanders into the Devil's Road and uses the teleporter. Kane follows it and it takes him to a room like Cluia's, where Cecil and Rosa are unconscious. The mysterious figure emerges from the mirror and confronts Kane. He claims to be Kane's true self, reflecting his true desires. He says that deep down, he has always wanted Cecil gone and tells Kane to finish him with the bloody spear. I have the option to kill him, but I choose not to. And so a fight is triggered against Dark Kane. I start by using a light curtain to give Kane reflect, because I know what's coming. Dark Kane will reveal his true form, Luna Bahamut. To make up for having to solo this fight with Kane, Luna Bahamut has the lowest HP of the Lunar Eidolons at 50,000 HP. He starts with his Mega Flare countdown, which my reflect will deal with, but just in case it runs out, I have to time my jumps to avoid it too. I usually wait until the timer reaches 2, that just gives me the time to avoid it. It will then counter the jump with 2 weak physical attacks. And I just keep that timing up for several cycles until I've done that 50,000 damage. As long as you get a good rhythm going, you should be able to avoid all his mega flares. I get Summon Book LB for defeating him. I get the Dragoon Gloves, which change Kane's jump to the more powerful double jump. The Bloody Spear begins to glow and transforms into Kane's ultimate weapon, Abel's Lance. This is a good one. It gives Kane 255 attack and can randomly cast Tornado on the enemy it hits to reduce them to single digit HP. Kane looks at himself in the mirror and says that this is the way things should be before it fades out. Kane leaves, it having just been seconds for Cecil, and decides not to tell Cecil what went on in there. I move on and 2 floors down into Cid's section I get a floor with a single chest in the middle containing the Rainbow Robe, the strongest armor for Rydia. I leaf through the back. Then nothing happens until the first floor of a twin section, where I get a copy of the Mount Ordeal Summit, starting from the save point. Inspecting the door to Cluia's room gets me the Caesar's Plate, Cecil's strongest armour. I then leave through the only exit there is. The next new floor I get just has me repeating the Mist Cave in reverse. South, northwest, south, northwest of the first chest. Backtrack southeast and all the way north, then east of the second, west and south a little, and west and north of the third chest, then all the way south, east, south, and west to the exit. First chest is a Mystic Whip Viridia, second chest is a White Fang, third chest is a cottage, and that's all. Skipping into the final section, I take on the Brachioridos again. Cecil absorbing elements already makes things much easier. That plus my higher levels and better equipment, and I manage to take this guy down again for a second hero shield. I give this one to Rosa. Nothing else happens before I finish my second full journey through here. Time to go back to Mysidia and bench Edward for Rydia. Since I reached Cain's trial, Cecil and Cain are level 77, Edward and Edge are 76, Rosa 75, and Rydia rejoins at level 72. I also swap Edge for Young, who is level 75 now. I give Young his Dragon Claws and Rydia the Mystic Whip and Rainbow Robe. Now it's time for a third journey through. During this one, I get the last new room in Young's section of the ruins. From the start, I go west through the wall and all the way south, then west again. I go north, going east through a wall halfway to the first chest. Then I go further north and go east through another wall to the second. I backtrack all the way south and then west through a wall, then to the next wall where I turn north, go east through the wall halfway up, then east into another end, and then north and west to the third chest. The exit is directly in front of where I started. The first chest is a Dry Aether, as is the second. The third is an X Potion. By the time I've reached the room with Rydia's trial, Cecil and Cain are level 78, Rosa and Young level 76, and Rydia level 73. I enter Rydia's trial to find a cave filled with mist. Rydia walks off ahead and is surrounded by the mist and reduced to her child form. Four of her Eidolons then leave her, the four with no story presence she gained when rejoining as an adult. So yeah, we get child Rydia again for this trial, a neat use of an old temporary version of the party member. Kind of makes me wish we could have got some use for Dark Knight Cecil, or Teller. There are five paths in this dungeon, the four corners and directly north, which is blocked off for now. My first fight here gets a new enemy, the Mist Eagle. My next gets the other two new enemies here, Mist Kraken and Mist Summoner. I follow the path from the southwest corner which takes me to Ifrit, who doesn't remember Rydia and needs his memories beaten back into him. Ifrit has 70,000 HP, absorbs fire and has an ice weakness. He has Flame and Fire Rigor like Luna Ifrit and Flamethrower to damage the entire party. At this point this is easy. Cecil and Young attack, Cain jump, Rosa heal, and Rydia throw out Blizzigers. He goes down in no time. I next take the path from the southeastern corner. This path leads to Shiva, who has also forgotten Rydia. Shiva has 64,000 HP, absorbs ice, and has a fire weakness. She's very easy, just the same strategy as last time, but with Rydia casting Fire Rigor instead. It's over in no time. Next is the northeast corner to find Rama. 60,000 HP, no weaknesses, nothing to absorb. Once again the same strategy, but with Rydia casting Flare. A chunk of the fight footage corrupted, but whatever, it's over in a few turns. I will say that I like them putting these four to use, even if it's just a minor role, considering all of them except for Titan's one moment had no real presence in the original. Speaking of Titan, he's found from taking the northwest corner. Titan is the same as Rama, a little more HP with 75,000, no weaknesses, nothing to absorb. I even use the exact same strategy. The reason I've had Float this entire trial is in preparation for him. It's over in no time. With those four defeated, I can take the centre path north where the voice gives Rydia her final challenge. The Lunar Dragon has 105,000 HP, no weaknesses and absorbs holy damage. Like the Mist Dragon, it can turn into pure mist and counter with Freezing Mist if you attack it in that state. It will use Sleeping Gas and Poison Gas along with Slow and can heal itself for the damage cap with Restore. At this point I'm using a similar strategy to what I used for the last two boss fights. Cecil attack, Young use Deadly, Cain jump and Rydia cast Flare. Rosa has more to do with healing, curing ailments and casting Flare when I can. Fittingly, Rydia gets the last hit in with Flare. It drops the last summon book, LD. Rydia gains her true self back and learns just how important those now power crept Eidolons are to her. She also gains the Mist Ring. When this is equipped, summoning the Mist Dragon will also cast Blink on the entire party. And that's all the Lunar Trials completed, but there are still a few odd ends to finish, including the final true challenge. On another repeat of Cecil's trial, I get another new room. A soldier needs to go pick something up, so asks me to guard a chest behind him. To clear it, I just have to wait. To fail, I have to either leave or open the chest. After waiting over a full minute, the soldier will return and I can go. I grab another golden apple belonging to that old man and give it to Rydia. That's all for this one. Going back through Rosa's section, I get the last room of hers I needed, based on the first floor of the Tower of Zot. I go north to the west corner for a chest, and all the way north to the exit. The chest is Remedy. That's it. I then repeat Rosa's trial, and knowing where the monsters are this time, I save the last kid at the end of the lake. My reward for saving them all is the White Ring. Equipping this turns Rosa's prey into Miracle, which does the same thing but heals for a lot more. By the time I finish that repeat, Cecil and Kane are level 80, Rosa and Young are level 77, and Rydia is level 75. Going through Edge's section again, I get the last of its rooms, based on the Cave of Eblan. From the start, I go south to the exit, taking a detour northwest to a chest. Yet another dry ether. That's all until I reach the final section and take on the Brachioridos again. With two party members absorbing its strongest attacks, it's getting even easier. I give the third hero shield I won from it to Rydia. But now I have all the summon books, I can do something about this final room. Cecil and Kane are now level 82, Rosa and Young are level 79, and Rydia is level 76. I head north to meet a fiery figure claiming to be Zeromus, yet not Zeromus. This is Zeromus EG, who hopes for an interesting battle from us. Zeromus EG has 200,000 HP, absorbs nothing, and has no weaknesses. He carries just about all of the original Zeromus' move pool. Big Bang, Black Hole, the spells. He'll also cast Reflect on himself and status spells on the party. Rosa is set to deal with all that and heal while Cecil attacks. Kane jumps, Young uses Deadly, and Rydia casts Meteor to bypass that Reflect. Zeromus EG also has Whirlwind and Eidolon attacks like Tidal Wave and Earthquake. He'll also cast Drain and Osmos, but they don't do much. So while this is going on, what's with the name? I'm sure most people know this, but EG most likely stands for Easy Game, the Japanese exclusive Final Fantasy IV Easy type that the US SNES version was mostly based on, changed Zeromus' sprite for the final battle for some reason. When they decided to add a new super boss for the GBA version, they decided to use that sprite for Zeromus EG. I think it's a cool detail, managing to rework something that otherwise would have just been a forgotten curiosity into something people would remember. As for this battle, maybe it's just my levels, but Zeromus EG is possibly the easiest super boss I've faced in the series. I have never game overed against this boss once. Despite his high HP and the length of this fight, I never felt in any real danger. As his HP runs low, he'll use Leech to heal himself for small amounts, but it's only a slight delay of his loss and Young is the one to get the final hit in. Zeromus EG says he was unaware that there were people who could defeat him. My reward? Nothing, I just get to leave. No useless item to prove I did it like Omega in Final Fantasy V, no cheesy certificate in the menu like Omega Weapon in Final Fantasy VIII. But whatever, my bestiary is at 99%. I'm missing just two enemies from it now and need to visit just two more rooms in the Lunar Ruins. It takes many runs through Young and Edward's sections to get the last room in Edward's, the Chocobo Forest. This is where the last few treasures I never obtained in the failed GBA room were. Going east from the start into the trees lets me find a Remedy and a Phoenix Down, but I accidentally leave the screen, leaving a treasure behind. 5 minutes later, I'm back and in the southeast corner. I find a hidden passage to a Gasal whistle. All that's left to deal with is the final room. On the way to the end, the room with a single refilling chest gives me a ribbon that goes to Young. The final room I get, in the final section, is a simple room that splits off towards the end before coming back together as one with the exit there. Inside, there are numerous dolls wandering around who trigger fights on contact. First there's the Grudge Puppets, evil doll palette swaps. Others are Death Puppets, palette swaps of Calcabrina. These are strong enough to get the boss music, with their 60,000 plus HP. But they're not a threat at this point, and so I just go around the room killing every single one of them. Once every single one is dead, a chest appears containing Nirvana. It's the strongest staff for Purim, giving her a huge attack boost and casting Reflect when used as an item. I return to Mysidia to give it to her. By the time I get back, Cecil and Kane are level 86, Rosa and Young level 83, Rydia level 79, Cid level 82, Edward level 85, the twins level 87, and Edge level 85. And that's it for this episode. I now have a 100% full bestiary and have picked up every treasure in the game. Next episode's part will be much, much shorter, as in less than 10% the length of this one. I know because it's already been made before I started working on this video, and will have me cover certain rare drops. As for the Lunar Ruins itself, I liked a good chunk of the trials for their use of the characters, most of them suit them well, and the only one I hated was Edge's for being tedious. The randomised rooms were another story though, I found that a pain in the arse. When you're trying to get a specific room that's several floors down and have to repeat it if you don't, it can get irritating. But I'm glad it's there and it adds to the game's replay value. Its addition also makes the completion of this perfect save much more reasonable, and I can't complain too much with that in mind.